Bună după amiaza sau bună ziua și bine ați venit la evenimentul de lansare al policy paper-ului scris de către colegii noștri de la ENOP. Cred că este simplu pentru toți să desfășurăm conferința noastră în engleză. Nu cred că este o problemă. Există traducere. Cine dorește căști, ele se pot lua de pe masă. So I will switch to English. Say all of our guests, welcome. Welcome to our audience and also welcome to our friends from ENOP, the European Network of Political Foundation. The Social Democratic Institute is the founding member of ENOP and the only Romanian political foundation part of this umbrella organization that gathers together political foundation from all political currents, all different political views in Europe. And for telling you more about ENOP and ENOP activity, I will give the word to Ms. Frederike Gensen, who is project manager in ENOP, and a bit more what ENOP does and why we are here today speaking about this project. The conference would be moderated by Dan Carbunaru, that you all know, and Adrian Dobre and I will be also like kind of listening to our colleagues your about guest. The paper. Your guest. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very happy that we are able to hold this conference here today. And first of all, I would like to thank Manuela and Adrian to host us here and to offer the opportunity to present our paper. ENOP, the European Network of Political Foundation, exists since more than 10 years. We have more than 60 member organizations from 23 European countries. And I have to read it, otherwise I make maybe mistakes. The Institutul Social Democrat Ovidiu Șincai is I trained this afternoon. is a member almost since the beginning and has supported our umbrella organization in many regards, has written an article on their summer school and has cooperated with the others in trainings and in conferences and has given a lot of input in several regards. And we would like to express our thanks for being such a good partner and such an important member organization. And this is not, not in a way only polite to say that. It is really coming out of a good long experience, and I'm working for this network since 8 years. I would like to introduce you the other participants today from ENOP, which all first is Arnold Kammel, who is our co-president elected since 1 month, and he's the chair of the working group Citizenship, which has drafted and published the paper we want to present today. I would like to present you two of the other authors, Jelmen Hase from Belgium and Panos Kakoliris from Greece, who together with other colleagues from all party families have co-drafted this paper to contribute to a more, let's say, common view what political foundations can do in civic education inside Europe. Normally, the European Network of Political Foundation works on promotion of democracy inside developing countries outside Europe. But of course, this has an impact as well and a dimension inside Europe. And I'm happy to see here a lot of panelists, despite the fact we are in interesting, let's say, times here in Romania. And I would like to thank the audience to come this afternoon here. And I would like to give the floor to the panel.
Thank you very much. Before entering the panel, I would like to thanks for hosting this meeting to the representation of the European Commission in Romania. they used to do a lot of good things, and I would put on this list as a journalist, of course, this meeting, hosting this meeting. It's another proof that the representation of the European Commission is taking serious its role to promote the European values, and it could be a good occasion to do it together today. So it is an interesting period indeed in Romania, but I would say that it's also an interesting period also for European Union, and it's very useful to see how the different approaches of the political families can interact through dialogue, and in this way to find the right way and the right vision for our common future in the European Union. I'm an Euro enthusiast as a journalist. It's not my job description, it's my dream, and I want to see it as a living dream. So together with you, maybe we could find some interesting way to lead this dream together. And before entering the panel, actually, I'd like to salute the presence here of Mr. Dan Mihalache, Head of Chancellery, Romanian Presidency. As you said earlier, we are living interesting times, and the Romanian Presidency is also joining these times. So please, Mr. Dan Mihalache, before entering the panel, if you could say some words. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation from the Institutul Social Democrat Ovidiu Șincai, which I know from the very, very beginning when it was founded, and some of us had this idea to push political foundations and to create solid and solid institutions in think tanks beyond political parties. Well, indeed, there are interesting and hot times for Romania and for Europe, and I believe the title of your report about reconnecting Europe with its citizens, also through the role of political foundation, could be essential in those times. I would say three things from the experience of the last 25 years in Romania, and I think we should be very grateful that big political foundations were very much involved in the process of the democratic transformation of Romania after 1989. And in my memory, there are the efforts made by the old German political foundation, talking about Konrad Adenauer, Hans Seidel, Friedrich Ebert, but also, if I remember well, about the Austrian ones, about the French ones, Jean Jaurès. So there was a double objective which we followed during, now I believe, hundreds or thousands actions and seminars with our friends in Western political foundations. First, disseminating democratic values in the society, but also they had an important role, and we must admit it, in the recruiting and training the new Romanian political elites. And if I look to the political landscape, I could see people that are now in decision-making process in Romania, and they were, during this training processes, in those years by foundations. And I think we are also heading now, the involvement is nicht mehr, not so high anymore. Also, the institutes from America are slowly retiring and going to other areas. It is a loss for us, but we could understand that we are in another stage of democratic development. But also in Romania, there is developing a system of political foundations which looks little bit more solid, except some attempts to double, triple from internal party political reasons, and this is happening in all political camps, not just in your camp. The second big thing I would say is that we should think about a state policy support about political foundations. And this is an issue which we tried to address sometimes in the years 2005-2007, but we didn't make it. Democracy costs, even though we are tempted to say parliament costs too much, parties cost too much, but we should stick to this principle that if we want a strong democracy, we have to spend some money for strengthening democracy, even though in this, there are very many populistic approaches. Perhaps in a more normal time, after the next election, we should think very seriously and build a coalition so that a law about financing the political foundation should be passed through the parliament, so that we, the political foundations, have also the necessary state aid for doing democracy dissemination, for doing this job. Well, I wish you good luck and count on my support.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mihalache. We need debates and we need policies and we need better trained politicians who should implement better policies, not only in Romania but also at the European level. And it is a challenge to connect these views at the national level but also at European level. How bad or how good is the situation at the European level? We could find listening to the next speaker. And we have the first intervention of Mr. Gelman Haase from Liberales, INOP member. And after that, we will be glad to listen to Mr. Panayotis Kokoliris from the Institute Konstantinos Karamanlis from Greece. So, Mr. Gelman Haase, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. I also appreciated that you mentioned that we need to find the right way for Europe. Actually, Amartya Sen recently wrote a very fine article about how the politicians are in our democratic system often punished for the mistakes that they make, but that the democratic debate and democratic process actually does not really necessarily lead to the right solutions. We should avoid mistakes, first of all. And I think this is part and parcel also of the paper that we have just written here, that we come to present here. It's about how to bring people together, how to bring forward the relevant issues, the relevant information, and how to connect politicians with society. This is where the political foundations exist, what they exist for, and they exist in between politics and between the people. And in particular for Liberales as well, we do it through events, to our media channels, as you are also using the social media, online media. And it is this debate that is indeed very relevant and very necessary. Better trained politicians, you also mentioned, and the training of politicians and of the new political elite obviously is very relevant. Also look at the example of Chevro that is mentioned in the paper. I would like to add also that information must be channeled to the people. The issues today are very complex. They are really, really complicated. Europe is challenging. Europe is a challenge, but it's a necessity. And formulating all of its challenges in an understandable, comprehensive manner, I think, is really difficult. And this is what we as political foundations try to do.
Very much. And yes, we need a new elite and new vision. But the most challenging thing seems to be getting the ordinary people together around ideas, maybe more important than around people, because we know that last year the experiment that Europe made with the running candidates for the job of the chief of the European Commission, it could be a solution, but we still need ideas and solution for Europe and not just heroes, political ones. So we have less and less people going to vote if we are talking about for European elections, for example. And the problem is who and maybe what we are voting for. And it also could be a challenge. So the next speaker we have, it's Mr. Panayotis Kokolidis. You have the floor.
So the solution can be the use of social media. And that was the idea behind of our choice to include social media as a special chapter in this policy paper. The fact that 40% of the EU population is using the social media as a source of information and a platform for dialogue. So it's not an overstatement to argue that social media is an important tool for our democracy. And let me say that it is an important tool to confront populism, the political phenomenon that I believe is now threatening Europe. Populist parties have become established and serious political players. They have exercised significant power influence, not only in their countries, but also at the European level. So it is remarkable that they have upgraded their propaganda, moving away from the traditional xenophobic issues towards Euroscepticism and towards promoting a new wave of nationalism. And this is a core issue for Europe now. We have seen that we have seen the proof of that in almost every recent elections in Europe. For all actors involved in the national or EU politics, these signs should be taken very seriously. These signs clearly point out that there is a growing distance between the EU structures and the policy making. And as Mr. Juncker said in an interview yesterday, EU integration should be an issue not only for the elites, but an issue for all EU citizens. And political institutes should have a key role in this effort to promote European ideas, make them more trendy, let me say, among the citizens. So, of course, populism is not a new political phenomenon. History is full of such examples, and usually these examples were very catastrophic. I could say that my country, Greece, is a catastrophic example of populism. So, what we have to do? What we have to do now as political parties, as political institutions, we have to address the real needs of the people. We have to give the right answers to their questions, but we also have to expose the populists, expose the demagogues. Defending unpopular and complicated realities and explaining them to the voters seem much more difficult than adapting to the populist demand. It is difficult to convince the public and to create public awareness. But it's not easy to achieve, but because usually populists dominate in also in the social media, in the media arena in general, but also in the social media especially. They're very bold, they base their views on real problems, but they don't give solutions. They use nice slogans, and they edit possibly very funny videos on YouTube, but they don't have concrete arguments. And this is their weakness. They don't have concrete arguments. We have to answer with arguments. Of course, there are no easy solutions to complicated problems. Everyone who is promising that that can give an easy solution to a complicated issue is not saying the truth. This is the reality. Social media can be used as a valuable tool to promote concrete political dialogue instead of the exchange of political slogans Of course, there are no magical solutions. Unfortunately, Harry Potter lives only in Rowling's books and not in our political life. So we have to try hard. We have to try hard, but I think that the social media is a tool to promote truth, is a tool to promote democracy and promote active citizenship. Before giving the floor, I would like to thank our Romanian colleagues for hosting us here, and also all the co-drafters of the policy paper, and the INOP people who have actually, Frederike and Alina, who have actually tried hard to help me coming here, because it's not easy to travel nowadays being a Greek, but because I'm here because of them, and I would like to thank them publicly. Thank you.
Thank you very much. 2 years ago, I was invited to talk to some students about European values and manipulation in mass media, and another colleague of mine began talking about manipulation from mass media, and I saw suddenly about 20 people getting bored in maybe 2 minutes, and I didn't understand why. After my colleague finished, I asked them, do you watch TV news? And they said no. Do you read newspapers? No. Do you listen news to the radio? And they said everybody, no. So how do you get informed? And everybody said, we are entering online and we read online information and social media. Okay, and don't you afraid to be manipulated on it? And they said no, because we make cross verification, and then we select our sources, and this is it. So this is the future, and I saw many analyses, especially on the other part of Atlantic Ocean. And the trend is indeed that the social media is becoming more and more important as a source for information for the, not only for the young generation, but anyway, in a few years they won't be any more a young generation. We will be active on the labor market, in the society, so I think the future cannot be better understood if we are not connected to the public through the social media. I have also the example of Calea Europeană, our website, which is promoting European values, and we have more than 20,000 people on our Facebook page, which is huge, I think, for a country like Romania. And as we promote only European values, it means that we have already a public interested in it. So we have to have the courage, not only in Romania, but in every member state, and to connect the ideas and the people together. We could interact with them, because social media is helping us to communicate each other, not just sending slogans and ideas at political entities. So indeed, it's an important. Mr. Dani Halache can confirm that our president has the record as a chief of state in the European Union. He has more than 1.5 million, 1.5 million fans on his Facebook page, and this is a confirmation that. So, Mrs. Merkel, I think it's having almost 1 million, or plus or minus. So, social media is a solution, and it's important to communicate arguments and the truth through social media, in the real time, of course. Well, for the next speaker, I would like to invite Mr. Ciprian Necula. He used to be also to be a representative of civil society, but he's invited now in a very active one. He's now Secretary of State at the Ministry of European Funds. So, Mr. Necula, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for this invitation. Actually, I didn't know that I would come to such an event. I just received an invitation from my friend, and then as well, so many people and such an interesting debate. And I had a chance to read those reports, fact sheets. I would like to do it, policy paper. But I just had a look on it quickly. As my colleague said already, I used to be an NGO active citizen, challenging the system in a way that I did believe that was necessary. I'm a sociologist by profession, so therefore I'm doing social anthropology, not quantitative work, but qualitative work. Therefore, I knew social realities that, you know, hurts me. I knew that people about people inequalities. I knew that we don't do that much for those people. And I raised my voice. I had a media presence challenging, as I said, government and all the other institutions. And To a certain extent, when you were talking in a fancy hotel in Bucharest about the poverty in Romania, the strategy on poverty, anti-poverty strategy, actually everybody was giving dates. I don't know, 1/3 of Romanians, you know, doesn't hold a whatever. I had that because I'm a sociologist. I said, okay, let's humanize a little bit the discussion. And I give the example of people without ID cards that are still living in Romania, that they cannot go to school and they cannot really, you know, have a job and they cannot really exist because they are linked with something that they cannot have, which is property, property rights. You cannot have hold a house without an ID card, and you cannot have an ID card without, you know, a house. And then their children are not going to have birth certificates. And if it passes a year, then they have to go to a trial and to, you know, to do DNA test and whatever, cost €1,000 and takes a year for people without, you know, ID cards and birth certificates, which means that they don't go to school anyway, they cannot be, you know, hired, they cannot be engaged in any social system security, and they cannot die because nobody will bury them. So bringing these social realities from the field, from the grassroots, I think was giving me the chance to act now. The Prime Minister challenged me, said, okay, that's a nice story, but you come and do it. I'm not a member of the political party, so you know, it was a hard decision for me to say, okay, I'll join a government that is quite political. But I did it. I did it because, of course, I have my own ideology, and here, just a small break, I really much appreciate the political foundations, because I think that we need to promote further ideologies. This confusion between what is left and what is right, what is social democrats and what is liberalism, it nerves me. I met a lot of politicians from Romania, liberals or social democrats, that didn't know anything about their own ideology. And that's, I think, very important for you to work on. I know the ideologies because I studied them. And also I have my own ideology. I'm struggling for the people that are living in that, you know, poverty area with a specific ethnicity too. I'm a Roma by origin too. And, you know, I have a certain ideology. But I saw to, you know, people that are engaged in politics that is really missing readings and action according to some ideologies. And that's a very important task that you have to carry on from my point of view. But getting back to my role, and I'll finish soon because I know that we are quite many to speak here. The dimension of social problems, it's very diverse. You know, we have a lot of social problems with a lot of groups, and the diversity of issues are very different from a group to another. Therefore, reconnecting Europe to its citizens, I think it's very much about what European identities are and how, you know, all the people that are under this political umbrella of EU citizens should be included. I saw a lot of exclusion with my own group as Roma from Romania. I saw a lot of noise from Western countries that we want to kick off and back Roma to Romania. I understand why, because they have this similar status of EU citizen. Well, probably we have to work more with, you know, people on what Europe is and reconnect people in all the diversity of European Union. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Indeed, it's a challenge, a social challenge also. I also agree that we cannot get together only because of the fears, the common fears that we have. We are talking about European elections last year and the fear of what was talking at that time in Russia and Ukraine and so on. And of course, for the politicians, they could benefit also from such crises, and their discourses could use fear instead of the solutions. But let's don't forget that the European Union is a source of solutions for the European citizens. And instead of that, sometimes, at least the perception level, it's showed like this, it's a source of problems. And if we agree that we have a lot of problems in the European Union, then we could stay together and talk about the common solutions and to proper communicate them to the people. Otherwise, we could see, and if you follow the last Eurobarometers in the last years, and especially the last ones, you will see that the common challenges that the European are focusing on, it doesn't matter if it is Germany or Romania or Belgium or UK, it's about labor market and economic growth. So it is a common problem, I think, for everybody. It doesn't matter the GDP and GDP per capita and so on, because it's just accountability. We should talk about people and of course about values. And if we talk about values, we can talk also about ideology. And with these things, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Alex Giboy, General Director of National News Agency Agile Press. Mr. Giboy.
Thank you very much. First of all, let me tell you it's a pleasure to be here, because I find it very interesting that a representative of national, be it public media, is invited to such a NGO type of event, which is very good. And I'm going to be brief. I was reading this policy paper, and two things, in fact, struck my eye. The first one is that you mentioned the role of social media and not the role of traditional media, which gives me an idea of how our public thinks. And it seems that our public seems to think that social media is becoming more and more important than traditional media. And the second one, and I'm not going to go deeper into that, because it would be a very, very long discussion about, and it would be mostly me trying to convince everybody that traditional media is safer and better than social media, so I'm not going to go into that really. But at the second chapter regarding the active citizenship, it was the definition, and I'm going to quote now. Active citizenship is a form of literacy. It implies being aware of what is happening around us, acquiring knowledge and understanding so as to make informed judgments, and having the skills and courage to respond, and so on and so forth. This is very much alike what I've been saying for the past 2.5 years about the role of media in regards to the society, be it European society, be it national society. In my opinion, media has a very important role in educating the public. This type of education may not be acknowledged publicly, or even acknowledged or understood by part of the media, but it still exists. Then, by this education, this education role is in fact helping the people become more aware, as it said in this definition I quoted earlier, helping the people become more aware, because when you have citizens which are not totally aware, because 100% is always very difficult to achieve, but when you have citizens who are very well informed from very trustworthy sources, then at least you can try to imagine that they can make the best, they can take the best decisions for themselves. Of course, this leads us back to the same discussion from where they take their information. And this is a problem which I see in media, be it social media or traditional media, that most of the signals are noise. You know, it's that theory which splits noise from information, and it says that we are surrounded by noise and we have to choose what type of accurate information is relevant to us at a given moment in space, time, and whatever. So, as we are capable to filter this noise and to acknowledge the useful information for us, then and only then can we make an accurate response, and then we can take decisions. Media, in my opinion, is a part of a, I don't know which geometrical form, because there's more and more actors. You can say that you have the political decision, the media and the public, and the media being the one that moves information between the political part and the public. You have social media now, you have a lot of other sources of information. So traditional media pretty much lost this bridge function between the politics or the public institutions and the citizens. So another part of this role of media, starting from education, we have many types of journalists. We have the active journalists, and you have this storytelling journalist, which storytelling journalists mostly are, in my opinion, what we are doing at the Romanian National News Agency. We're just telling the story. We're not commenting on it. We're not adding stuff. We're not extracting stuff. And when I say this, I realize again that traditional media is, in fact, the most reliable source of information. Because you go to a Facebook page, or your Facebook news feed, or your Twitter feed, or whatever. Of course, you can have the abilities to follow whoever you want and to like which page you like, and therefore you get the information. The algorithm is not really that you get the information that you need. The algorithm is that you get the information that you want to receive. And I have a funny story which I can't share with you publicly, but I will later after this discussion about some politician who was very amazed of his public feed in Facebook. So to cut it short, journalism as a form of taking information from the provider and getting it. To the citizen in the exact form it was produced, is in fact the most important thing. Because guess what? Without media, be it social or traditional, it would be very, very difficult to go back 300 years ago and just try to campaign door to door with 20 million people. Thank you.
The communication is essential in a country with 20 million people, and if we are talking about an European space with 28 states and half of a billion people, then the equation is complicating more. Which language we are talking to this public, and I'm not talking about the specific words, but the ideas that we are spreading. And if it is a challenge for journalists to communicate to the public, choosing to communicate what the public needs, what the public likes, and not necessarily it's the same. Imagine what are the dilemmas of the politicians, because they have to choose when they govern people. If they put on the table the solution the people like maybe Mr. Tsipras wanted to do at the beginning, and the second choice is to give the people what they need. So this is a challenge, and the transparency of this discussion is very important, and the role of the media is essential indeed, and maybe this is why talking about reconnecting Europe with its citizens through the political foundation, we include the social media and the media itself in this equation. If I understood well, this is the moment when we should thank a lot to Mr. Mihalache. We appreciate a lot your presence here. And I hope we will have the occasion to see Mr. Mihalache again to such important debates. Now, it is as far as the organizers brief me, it's the moment of the question and answer session. And as we have important people here together with us on both parts of the table, as I have been told, at least three German European foundations are represented today, Konrad Adenauer, Neumann, and Zeidel. So if you'd like to talk, you could do it in this session, and also Mrs. Gabriela Crețu, we salute her presence here, if she wants to have an intervention. So, if you want to comment on our debate or to ask questions, you are free to do it, please. I will need a help. Mr. Dobre told me he will help us with the communication now. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Reimar Wagner from the Friedrich Naumann Foundation for Freedom. And I want to give a positive statement because I have a positive feedback from you. And one of these is just an example from our work in Moldova. In a training, we sent locally elected people on the streets. It was a simple exercise. It was the first question, what you think that people need? And they write it down. After that, we sent these people on the streets and they come back. The outcome was amazing. But it's not Moldova. If you do this exercise on Germany, in Romania or in Brussels, the outcome will be the same. And I think it's important that so bodies like foundations, like political foundation, make this connection. So, and I just give you a concrete example of that. To the other, to your sentence, yes, we do in the last 20 years, I think, we have made one day or two day trainings with thousands of young people about what is liberalism, what is conservatism, what is socialism. In the last 20 years, we have the same huge success. But I think it's just a failure of our education system, because it's not a role maybe of the political foundations to teach really these basics, what means the one, the second, and the three. But we will keep on, and I want to argue a little bit with Mr. Mihalakian, but he's not here. I think with other colleagues, the German foundations are here and they are really present. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please.
Is this really necessary? Okay, I'll use it.
I'd like to ask you to come here because we have cameras.
Okay, just to introduce myself, I'm a Romanian student. I've been studying the last 4 years abroad in the United Kingdom. We too have had the pleasure to meet once in Brussels. Just a short question on the role of political foundations, because you've been talking about media, social media. These are essentially channels with some particular idiosyncratic characteristics, but they're eventually channels. They're outside, they would consider like an outsider or a voice strategy to raise awareness. Most of the times they're reactive. So once a policy issue is in the public sphere, that's when they react. But what about the proactive side? Because, and I'm talking now to the representative of Romanian think tanks, NGOs, and so on. What about the insider or the direct link to the specific, let's say, European institutions? So for example, the European Commission is one of the most transparent bureaucracies in the world. It's having open consultations where it receives basically opinions, informations from stakeholders. This can be think tanks, which can express one particular position for or against, let's say, a policy area, or from citizens themselves. How are you doing your job in terms of participating in these open stakeholder consultations, or how are you engaging people, ordinary Romanian citizens, to take part of them? Because just being a, let's say, some kind of debate in the public sphere will not necessarily make the link, bridge the gap to the actual policy making. And I think if we really want to engage citizens with the policymakers, we should better capitalize the direct links we have, like, for example, these public consultations or the actual MEPs we have in Parliament and the relationship citizens have with them, before necessarily involving, I don't know, general debates and so on and so forth. Thanks.
You, if I understood well, it's more like a proposal than a question, but who knows, maybe you have an answer.
Just a short answer about what we do as a political foundation in Romania, maybe it should be interesting. We believe that the political foundation can function beside being a think tank and giving solution for Romania's problems, also as a bridge between the public and the politics, and also as a training center or a training hub. So what we mainly do is trainings with young leaders from the political parties. We do specific trainings with our people, with the Social Democrats, with our elected people, if it's mayors or local councillors or MPs. But we also do common trainings with young leaders from various parties, putting people together around the same table. And we must say that this is a successful program. We also, I think, even in Rome have some people that participated and are still participating in this program and are from a different party than ours. And because we believe that it's not only important to find a solution, but it's very important to pursue a solution. And the solution should overcome an electoral cycle. So people should agree upon the solution and follow it further, even if the electoral actors change. You should follow the process, otherwise you're not getting to the results. So this is, and we also believe in the role of education and transmitting values. For a citizen to come to a political debate or a public consultation, he has first of all to know that this exists. It has to know that it has a right to come there, because we know a lot of citizens in many towns or even in villages that they are afraid to enter a place where the mayor lives because they are ashamed, or they don't know that this is their right to participate in that debate. This is our role. We have, as Dan Mihalache said here, very few means to do it. We try to do, as both Adrian and I, as volunteers, a lot of actions, but it would be more important to find a way to finance this foundation, and I think the German example is a very good one, because democracy is not something that you teach a generation. You have to teach each new generation, starting from the scratch, the rules of democracy. So it's a continuous process. It's not a process that we say, oh no, you're in the EU, you don't need to teach it the new generation. So finance would be an important issue so you can engage more people, because not everybody wants to spend its life voluntarily doing politics, even if it's fun and interesting. So I hope I answered some of your concerns. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other answer to this question? If not, please.
Pot vorbi în românește?
Yes.
Se poate?
Just a second to assure that everybody who is not speaking Romania is having a translation system connected. So give us 2 minutes, please.
Îmi pare rău că crezi o... Prefer să mă exprim în românește. Se poate? Îmi cer scuze încă o dată, văd că am creat o problemă. Două observații. În primul rând, mă raliez foarte direct celor spuse de domnul Giboi, directorul general al Rompresului, al Agerpresului. Fiindcă eu cred în continuare în mass media tradițională. Numele meu e Niculescu, Adrian Niculescu, îmi cer scuze, n-am spus-o, Niculescu. Adrian Niculescu, la SNSP-a lucrez. Cred că mass media tradițională are un rol și o să vă dau un simplu exemplu. Căutam în urmă cu câtva timp pe ediția online al unui ziar, România Liberă, un anume articol. Am văzut un articol acolo, publicat, așa, la grămadă, la moară, ca la moară, pur și simplu. Totuși eram curios să văd ediția adevărată a ziarului, subliniez adevărată. Adevărata ediție este cea care apare tipărită, dar de vreo 300 de ani, de 200 de ani cel puțin apar. Și cred că nu trebuie să dispară. Și acolo mi-am dat seama greutatea articolului, când am văzut paginația, când am văzut cum a fost deci pus în pagină, relieful care i s-a dat, pozele pe care nu le vedeam. Vedeam o mică poză, dar nu reușeam să înțeleg citind numai ediția online. Și atunci am avut brusc intuiția că până nu vedem ziarul adevărat, nu avem percepția reală a cum este pusă în pagină, ce greutate îi se atribuie acelui articol, dacă îl vedem ca la moară reprodus așa pur și simplu, fiindcă, sigur, poate spuneți, da, du-te să vă cauți un PDF, dar articolul ăsta nu l-am văzut în PDF sau nu am avut eu acces la el. Toată lumea l-a văzut online așa cum l-am văzut și eu și am zis, stați un pic să vă arăt eu cum arată realmente acel articol. Asta este o chestiune la care m-am gândit imediat. Deci nu cred că trebuie să dispară, fiindcă este foarte important să vedem greutatea, pozele, dimensiunea pozelor. Era o pagină întreagă, altfel eu vedeam o chestie anodină, strict anodină. E vorba de o ziar România Liberă din ziua de 3 februarie, legată de ceva care cineva din sală știe despre cine e vorba. Așa, nu vreau să intru în amănunte, dar asta este un exemplu care poate să meargă la multe lucruri. În al doilea rând, aveam aici asta este un comentariu, o întrebare, pur și simplu, pentru domnul Nicula, Ciprian Nicula, care, în fine, nu mi-a fost direct student, dar tot de la SNSPA vine, sau? Am zis că ai făcut la paralel cu alți prieteni ai noștri, cu Iulian, cu ceilalți. Da, iertați-mă. Totuși, aici am o nedumerire. În primul rând, dumneavoastră sunteți secretar de stat. Un secretar de stat își asumă ideologia partidului care se află la conducerea acelui minister. Un secretar de stat, iertați-mă, nu poate să spună eu sunt independent, am ajuns acolo prin alunecare sau știu eu altfel, Sfântul Duh sau mă rog, altfel situație. Iertați-mă, nu e o ironie, decât așa, o glumă, să spunem așa, dar fiindcă ne cunoaștem. Totuși, trebuie să se asume persoanele care sunt într-o poziție de demnitari. Chiar dacă nu sunt membri de partid, dar într-un fel sau altul trebuie să aibă o compatibilitate cu acel curent de gândire ideologică. Altfel nu ne putem plânge. Iată, oamenii nu știu ce este liberalismul sau întrebăm pe cineva, era un antevorbitor care spune asta, cineva care are, nu știe să facă o diferență între liberal sau socialist sau conservator și sunt oameni, tocmai se creează niște confuzii, domnul Ciprian, iertați-mă. Trebuie asumat, da domne, am niște idei așa, nu sunt membru de partid, sunt independent în cadru, există posibilitatea să fii un independent care aderă la ideile, știu eu, social-democrate, liberale, conservatoare sau așa mai departe. Asta este mica observație și dacă puteți să ne dezvăluiți și noi, am spus de mai multe ori, aveți o ideologie, dar poate ne dezvăluiți care este. Ne-a spus de mai multe ori, am o ideologie a mea. Am vrea, dacă nu suntem indiscreți, să o aflăm și noi. Vă mulțumesc și iertați-mă de inconvenientele tehnice.
Mulțumesc, domnule profesor. Iată, o provocare personală, domnule Nicula. Dacă doriți să răspundeți la ea acum sau poate
acum, după. Domnul Niculescu mi-a fost profesor în facultate de științe politice, unde învățam ideologii, printre altele. Nu, sigur, facultate de științe politice, unde dumnealui predă istoria. Deci, e o legătură directă. N-am ascuns niciodată că sunt un om de stânga, declarat, nu știu dacă, și de multe ori am fost critic la adresa partidului care se află acum la guvernare, că nu știu dacă e chiar de stânga. Aici este, de fapt, confuzia. Eu știu clar în ce direcție merg, dar n-am încă siguranța că partidul la guvernare este un partid de stânga. De aici poate doamna Gabriela Crețu, care este membra Partidului Social Democrat, ne va spune mai multe. Vă mulțumesc mult, domnule profesor.
Thank you very much. Well, Gabriela Crețu, former, future, everything else currently, member of the Senate, left-wing politician and member of Social Democratic Party, both of them. Well, I am a challenger. I used to challenge, as Ciprian as well said, the system, but from inside. And you, the political foundations, are, from my point of view, a part of the system. For this reason, today I have 4 days of holiday. I given up for 2-3 hours writing on my book, and I come here to listen to you, to meet you. And generally, I don't agree with you. And I wrote down 3-4 ideas, not to speak too much. We need new political elites. I don't believe that we need elites, not at all. We need democracy, genuine democracy, participation, awareness, control on public institutions functioning, and regulation on the private ones. And we need to build capacity to do it. And one of your goal is this, to build capacity to do this kind of things. Secondly, we need to introduce Europe and European values to our citizens. European political foundations are not the PR of a kind of Europe we want to sell. We need to build citizenship, political culture, to spread valuable information and to challenge the present, producing new and better ideas, projects about the future. Thirdly, I don't see the use, I know the use, but I don't see the use of a network. I see the necessity of a kind of, including competition, if you want, between you, thinking that you represent different, I hope, political ideologies, not the same ideology as I felt a bit. Third, and finally, social media and media is useful to politics if and only if the citizens are used to do politics, are interested in politics, are interested in being informed about society, world, and everything. If not, we could have social media and everybody discussing about nice girls or boys to avoid any kind of discrimination. Not about what is needed to do in society. And being in Romania, too, I shall make only a short comment about hot times. Always it has been hot times in Romania is not a problem. When for the first time I entered the European Parliament 10, 11 years ago, my European colleagues told me that they think in Romania there is somebody always happy. Who? I asked. The journalists. They don't have to look for a piece of news to write something, because always it happens something. This is not, it is a kind of joke, a sad one, because as you have seen, we have a presidency which have been forbidden by constitution doing politics and doing it, at least by its representative, our former colleague, Dan.
We have political foundations rejecting the idea of doing politics, so everything is okay. We can goes on. Thank you.
Very much. And as we have, just a second, please. We have first Mr. Panayotis Kokolidis, and then, as Mr. Kretsou said, we need rules. So the rule is that we follow the orders, even if we have elites here. And I think that if we have rules, it's not necessary not to have elites. And if we have elites, it doesn't matter. It doesn't mean that we don't need rules. I think we need rules and elites in the same time. So, and then Mr. Djiboy, and then Sven, nice to see you again. You will have the floor. So
there was not a question there, but I would like to answer a question to the gentleman over there about social media. You are right, and I totally agree with you. Traditional media have to survive, and I also agree with Alex. I'm a traditional journalist myself. But when I have to learn about what's going on in an EU summit, I was expecting Donald Tusk to tweet that there was a solution to the Greek problem. So that is reality. Of course, I prefer traditional journalism, and if you ask me, I prefer the kind of BBC values, journalistic values, where you double check or triple check your sources. But in reality, now the way to be informed is totally different. There are more sources, and we have the chance to have access to that and have access to quicker information and try to judge how accurate you are.
It's the clash of ideas. The institutional build-up actually brings people together. It's in its essence harmony. But there's also the very different opinions sometimes that we have, and just talking about it brings us together. This clash of ideas, this conflict, this is also a natural element of society, is also part and parcel of the diversity and of the build-up of INOP. And this for us actually is what we want to share. This is also what this is all about. And this is what we have met and lived through actually in writing this paper. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Haase. Now Mr. Djiboy, and then Sven Irmer, and then we have a first question.
Thank you. Two short comments. The first one to our younger student colleague. You said something about the media being a channel for politicians, or, well, theoretically and ideally, it should be only a channel, you know, a channel who is very well polished, so none of the stuff flowing through it gets stuck on the walls or added something else. Theoretically, you're right, it should be just a channel. But unfortunately, we all have the awareness, I hope, that is not only a channel. And the second comment to Ms. Kretsou, I don't know if I understood correctly, but you said something like media being useful to politicians, something, something. No, you didn't?
How to say? To mix content and the medium, and to say we have new media, social media, and it is open and accessible, and etc., etc. Yeah, and we forget about the content, which kind of content we use to promote, which kind of readers of this content we have. So besides having classic media or new media or social media, we have to choose ideology, projects, content to build capacity to be received by
you, citizens. You have to learn to be very good translators. You know, you have to translate your political debates, your NGO debates, your political foundation debates into, let me say, popular. You know, you have to translate your high ideas.
Yeah. We have to into, speak understandable.
Yeah.
No.
That's it. You have to make yourself
everybody
understood.
Everybody has to have a kind of interpreter with him.
And my short comment was that media should only be useful to citizens and, of course, itself. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Sven Irmer. I'm the director of the Konrad Adenauer Foundation. Maybe some of you know the foundation. Thank you, Inop, for doing this very important work. I think it's a good first milestone to do, but there must be more to come, and I'm quite optimistic that there will come. It's very interesting that the left is talking about having no elite in a country like Romania. Sorry, there is a political elite. As a leftist, you're not talking about it, but we see it every day. So, and of course, I have the opinion we need a political elite. Who will make the decision in future? It's nothing bad to have an elite. Yeah, it's only bad when you talk about an elite who's not capable to do proper decision. And there's nothing to do if it's left or right or center or whatever, but it starts in Romania, for example, to tell the people what you stand for. A social must have a socialist opinion. This is nothing bad about. Or a social, call it social democrat when we compare it with German values and rules. Yeah, so for a center-right, so EPP-orientated foundation, what CAS is, yeah, it's good to know who we are, where we are standing. Though Konrad Adenauer has a name, the other foundation in the room from Germany also stand for something. So this gives orientation. This is very, very important that the people who join our seminars know that we are not like in between, that we have rules. And that the people who are coming to us and asking for support know what we support and what we not support. Of course, I will not support any talk about socialist ideological things. Yeah? So I talk about social and market economy. Yeah. So my mindset is a total different than what you have. So it's good and it's important, but we have to teach young politicians, people who are disorientated, to say, okay, what is in your mindset? What do you want to have? You want the liberal way, you want the social market economy, or you want to see again what we saw in the former GDR here in Romania? And I hope this will not be the way. So, but we have to start this kind of discussions. And this is where it starts. Nobody explain me, and sorry to add this, when I talk to socialists here in this country, they cannot explain why they're in the Socialist Party. They simply don't have a clue if they are capable to explain the youngsters why it's good to join the Social Democratic Party in Romania. Fine, let's go. So the frustration, and this is what foundations are fighting for, the frustration, people are disorientated in this country. Nobody knows what is really going on. When we look, what we are doing as a foundation, we try to explain what is happening here the last 3 years. And what I don't agree is political foundations are not like only a translator or working on social media, making nice events, going to fancy restaurants and hotels and invite people from Europe. Sorry, no. We are a political actor. We are a political actor because we take over more and more the role of politicians about their country, who don't care about the next generation and who have no clue what will come after them being in power. And this is what we are doing. We explain what is going on in Europe because there are politicians who are elected in the European Parliament. They don't explain at home what is happening in Europe. So the trust in Europe is going down tremendously. This is what we're fighting for as foundation. And my colleagues will agree when we talk about that. We are partly taking over the role of politician. And to say so, sorry to say so, this is not a good development. And of course we're kicking, sorry, asses and say, care about the youngsters in your parties. Care about them. They will go away. They don't show any more interest. So the role of foundations, foreign foundations, and this is the interesting point, we care sometimes more about the youngsters than the people who should care about them. And this is, after 25 years in Romania, a development I don't like. My aim is to close down here my office one day because I think Romania is a proper developed country in democratic rules, respecting the rule of law, and everybody has the chance who deserves it. This is my aim. Yeah, I don't want to close the office because I think Romania is not interested. No, it's a sign of normality to close something when you reach your aims. Yeah, of course this is not like, but I tell this also to my political friends in Pinele. Yeah, this should be normal to say, okay, we have maybe office with one or two people. But this is what we have to carry on and fight for, and not like to stay here forever and be the rich uncle from the West spending thousands and thousands of euro every year. No, the political class, the political elite has to act now and has to understand now that if it's not done now, 25 years after, again, we have to need 25 years, and this is quite too long for this beautiful country. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think Mrs. Crețu will have to, maybe if she wants a short answer, because after that we have a question, and then Mr. Nicola's a short commentary. Nicole from Hanseidel.
10 seconds, only. I'm a professor of politics. I forgot stressing. And I have noticed you are a political actor, but you are not at all a democratic political actor. Because in my science, elites, it is not a concept belonging to democracy. I'm sorry. We shall build then aristocracy, perhaps, slavery, perhaps, etc., etc. No, I'd like to build a democracy. I'd like to be. I don't understand.
Okay, let's move on the next question, please. Anyway, it was a very interesting intervention and a very challenging one, as earlier Mrs. Crețu had, but of course with a different approach and maybe a more political challenging position.
Thank you very much. I'm Radu Mușetescu. I'm an associate professor at the Academy of Economic Studies, so I'm an academic. And sometimes we draw inspiration both in a negative or a positive way from in Europe, from the political process in United States. And I will challenge our guest today if we can compare the role of political foundation in Europe with the role of political foundation in United States. And my personal impression is that in United States we have some institutions or foundations like Cato, Heritage, Brookings institutions, which are closer to the political decision making than in Europe, and they are acting like a revolving door for policymakers. So a triage for preparing these policymakers. We are talking not about political leaders, but let's say medium political decision makers. And also when they end office for engaging, employing and keeping them in the political debates. So my impression is that in Europe we do not witness such a process, and if our guests can make some comments whether this is true or not. Thank you.
Before you have the answers, I will ask Mr. Ciprian Nicula, who wanted to make a short comment on maybe the previous issues.
Yes, thank you very much. And I will refer to the comment that was before from the right-wing colleague. Sorry, I don't remember your name, that's why I'm Svet. Well, first of all, everything should be with politeness, you know, we don't debate in such a way, but I hope that that should be the way in such a context, first of all. And secondly, democracy means also elections. And if you represent a political class and you are the will, you're not elected. That's what probably Gabriela meant. You know, you are a foundation, so you cannot replace politicians because you are not elected. That's the thing. Secondly, I'm really curious to see what is your definition of elites, because I have probably, or we have, other understanding of this concept. Thank you.
Okay. It could be a very nice dialogue, but as we have already a question to our guests, maybe if we'll have enough time to go back to the previous issue, okay?
It's becoming a very difficult debate in the sense, in my opinion, NGOs have also always been democratic actors, as actors in democratic society, as our political foundations. I fail to really understand that the distinction that you are making now, and particularly coming from an NGO background. But that is one thing. Also, you referenced to the U.S. and how things operate over there. Talking from my organization, well, we are all volunteers, 100% volunteer based. So politicians that will later be employed by us, well, I don't think they're really. That said and done, there are members of parliament, there are members of cabinet, and so on that are in a member of our organization. Yes, indeed, we try to influence. We try to analyze. We also think that you just make a distinction between active journalists and storytellers. One of the roles that we really believe we have is comes from the understanding that there's no such thing as objectivity. You always talk from a background. You always have some kind of educational heritage and background that you take along. So that, I think, is very strange, I think, to say we're just storytelling. There's always framing, indeed, media and newspapers and so on. Would we want to go to an American system? That's perhaps the next question that logically comes from it. From our organization, no. No, that's not our ambition. In a sense that we, as such, don't look for the big money. There are elements of an American system that we can learn from, for sure. There are things that are better there than here. There are things better in other countries. But that's going in detail. But from our organization, I can only say that, yeah, it's totally different.
I could say just a few words about what's going on with Greece and the political foundations. Practically, my foundation works as a mediator between the political parties and the government and the academics. So we're very happy with that. Perhaps if I was working to an American institute, I would be better paid. But I'm very happy trying to bring academic ideas closer to the political life of my country. Thank you.
Just to come back to it, given we don't have the United States of Europe, we have no thing like the National Endowment for Democracy, for example, which is then distributing the money to the different think tanks. So it's just not comparable because each country has its own structure for these kind of think tanks. In Poland, it's even forbidden to have political foundations in a way. Each country has its own legal framework. It's not comparable.
Thank you very much. Now, if we have other questions, please. And if you'd like, please step forward because we have cameras. And okay. As we are streaming live the event, it could be useful for our viewers to see who is speaking now. Thank you.
My name is Carolina Novak. I'm a student at University of Bucharest. So my question is, previously you talked about social media. And so my question is that, don't you think that politicians and general presidents, prime ministers, and member of parliaments, nowadays they try to marketize, I would say, so their message through using social media. And so in this respect, the media itself loses its strength with politicians, and so social media is getting the power. So I would say, in this sense, politicians, they're very subjective on social media. So what can media nowadays to do and to solve this problem? Thank you.
It is challenging. I don't want to answer, but it is challenging because if we compare a Facebook page with a politician followed by 1 million, 1 million and a half people, it's very difficult to challenge that page as a newspaper with maybe 100,000 viewers a day. So yes, it's challenging even in quantitative aspects, but important is the content and the interaction with the public. So maybe this one could be, and the credibility, of course, of the source. So anyone wanting to?
I could say a word, yes. In fact, if I'm tweeting, I'm only having 140 characters. Yes, I can tell you that there was a solution to the Greek problem, as I said, if I'm tweeting from Brussels, but I cannot explain to you what really happened. This is the job of traditional journalists, and this is why I think that traditional journalists will continue to have a very good value in our society.
Okay, so you talked about traditional media. What are we supposed to do to fight the big bad social media coming to eat us, right? We have to coexist, at least in the beginning, because at this moment there is no general solution which can be applied generally to all sorts of media in regarding the collaboration to social media. You have now Google News, you have Facebook article, who started collaborating with some very big media organizations in the West, which started on their own publishing material exclusively on Facebook, so therefore the importance of the page. But please allow me not to be very, not to agree very much with this 1.5 million followers on Facebook as being real and not adequate, sustainable. Because trust me, but I do not believe that each one of these 1.5 million people are every day on Facebook looking at what that politician has to say. And that is about, that can be applied to 10,000 followers, to 20,000, and to 1.5 million, sorry, not billion, million. Yeah? Okay, so it's the quality, it's not the quantity. The question is whether social media is real media, and the answer is no, not yet. One example, which is totally not linked to politics. When it was the unfortunate plane crash in Ukraine, some guys, some friends from the AP were scanning the social media for pictures, for videos, for whatever. They are using from AP, from Storyfy, and from Reuters, because it's a, yeah. And they, in order to verify the accuracy of the photographs provided to them in the videos, they had to check the weather reports, they had to check the time of the day of the photo, not of the crash. They had to check the shadows in the photos, and they had to check on Google Earth to see if that location really existed at that exact location. So, of course, as traditional media, you can create a department in which to analyze and require and acquire the rights for certain news, be it video, written, or pictures. But that's only transforming some stuff, and I emphasize some stuff, on social media and transforming it into news. Because you cannot have to assume the fact that if somebody writes something on social media, and I'm talking about a person who doesn't have a political position or a public position or whatever, becomes instantly news for everybody. So if the president or the prime minister or a senator or whatever, it's his own choice to address the people on Facebook because he has the feeling that therefore his message will not be distorted. And it would, only would, reach a certain number of people. That's his own choice. And I'm going to link this to the comment on storytelling. You know, in my personal opinion, storytelling is the best, journalism. Because if you're not storytelling, then at the same time you must say what's on your own mind. And that's not journalism, that's analysis. Thank you.
I feel a little bit of feeling that we are living right now in a bubble. Speaking about social media, it's a very convenient subject for us, for all of us. We have all iPhones, we have all living in a city with a broad internet coverage and fast internet. But as Ciprian said before, we have 100,000 people in Romania that doesn't have IDs. We have a lot of people in Romania that doesn't have phones or doesn't have iPhones or doesn't have the possibility to get them. Not necessarily because the infrastructure is not there, but because they don't have the money to buy them and they don't have the knowledge to use them. And I think it's very important for us as political foundations to recognize this. Reconnecting Europe to the citizens means also these citizens. They are also part of Europe. They already are having a handicap, let's say so, to access the information. And in this area, the traditional media maybe is more helpful than the social media that we like, because it's a gimmick and it's new. But also, it's very important to not to exclude the politicians. They will go door to door and speak with the electorate and speak with the people and convince them about what's happening. And I think here, because sometimes I felt a clash, but Gabriela comes from a constituency who has, I don't know how many villages, but a lot of villages with people that live their normal rural life, even if they are, some of them are very bright, but they don't have maybe not all of them access to all these tools that we like to use. And I think it's correct for them to give them the same information that we give on social media, to give them directly. And this is also the role of political foundation, to train the people to give that information. And I think we shouldn't give up this role. Don't think that social media or local or media is just replacing our core job of speaking with people directly as a politician or as a political foundation. Thank you.
Thank you, Manuela. And of course, speaking of the people, and I was thinking about a news that I saw at one of the European councils, Council of the European Union under the Greek presidency. The ministers of labor met more than one year ago. More than one year, and they were talking about the European 2020 strategy, and you know, with one of the objectives for reducing poverty. With 20 million people, it's like Romania population until 2020, and actually at that time, they noticed that instead of decreasing the level of poverty, they discovered another 6 million people entering in the poverty area. But I didn't notice any big discussion at the European level about it, national one. So it's, I don't know if it's a left or right responsibility. I know that at least in the European Parliament, the EPP and SND got together to focus on defending Europe, and this is a mixture of ideas that could make some confusing perception in European level. And if you are talking about Romania, we can see that sometimes the left government take right measures and the opposite. Of course, yes. So it's very difficult for the people to understand from a party or from a European family, from the political point of view, if they are on the left side or on the right side. So if you are talking about facts, because you're talking about a tragic plane crash, actually almost everybody in the western part of Europe thinks that it was a terrorist attack, which is pretty different. So there are many things that we can approach from the left or from the right side, but the real things should be the same for everybody. And I think this is one of the, it's not a conclusion, but it's just what I think. It's very important not to be in competition as families, political families or political foundations, but to be in a dialogue. Sometimes, as we saw recently, in a very tough way. Yes. So, I think we have another intervention, and of course, Mr. Haase, you wanted to have the floor.
I think our discussion shifted a little bit away. We are political foundations. We are not here to solve analphabetism in Romania. For that, we have the Ministry of Labor, the Ministry of Education, and lots of NGOs to solve this on the grassroots. It's not our thing. It's not our task. Our task, to understand what is a political foundation, our task is to get these NGOs there on the grassroots, to get something from the Ministry of European Fundings, somebody from the labor, somebody from the education, to get together elites, yes, to have a policy paper about solving this problem for the next 20 years. And I think we shift a little bit too much in this, and I want maybe to bring the discussion back what we are and what we do. Okay, thank you.
Yes, I can only agree 100%. I think that's also, it's a bit too much social media versus traditional media. Both have their strengths and their weaknesses. We should be able to have an open debate about it. What we are here indeed is what we also do is we bring some of the opinion makers in society together. It's very difficult sometimes to get your voice heard across social media as an individual. It's still so, as research shows, that it's the same people that appear in the traditional media that are also the opinion makers on the social media. Getting those NGOs out, getting those people together, confronting them like we have here actually with some people, and engaging in a debate is very interesting. And that, I think, is what it's about. It's not about how do we frame, and of course, fact-checking is essential. I mean, fact-checking is essential, will always remain essential. Good fact-checkers will be crucial, even more so in an environment where there's social media. But listening to the people, now that is possible, why shouldn't we?
Thank you. As we are closing to the finishing the part of question and answer session, I would kindly ask you to ask any question you'd like. We still have 5-10 minutes for it.
Hello. As we highlighted it before, we saw that social media is very sensible to populist rhetoric.
Excuse me, can you present yourself, please?
I'm Alexis Chapelan, Romanian student. So I was wondering whether do you think that Facebook and other social media is by its nature more anti-systemic than traditional media, or it is just that populistic parties know how to exploit their characteristics?
Well, thank you for this question. If it's anyone who is wanting to answer on it, maybe a short answer.
You are right in principle, but it's easy to say a political slogan in Twitter, but it's difficult to analyze your political arguments in Twitter. So you're right in a way. Social media is an environment that populists can easily exploit, but that's why I have asked for the mainstream political actors to be more active in that, because I think that we can change the way the populists behave in social media by asking about arguments, by asking about the truth.
It's not necessary that the one who is having the more followers on Facebook or on Twitter to win the elections, for example. We made an analysis last year on the European elections, analyzing the channels of public communication, including the social media, with the principal candidates for the presidency of the European Commission had, talking about Twitter and Facebook. Mr. Schulz at that time was the leader, also Twitter and Facebook. Unfortunately for him and SND, he couldn't do it. So, and talking about Greece, recently, between the stop of the negotiations and the referendum, Mr. Tsipras posted on Facebook, I don't know, something here, something about the negotiations. And for the first time in my life, I could see changing the account of the likes that he had in seconds. So from 1 second from another, I could see counting, like, you know, in casinos, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, you know, it was crazy. I didn't see such a thing in my life. Unfortunately for him and Greece, it couldn't help him, Facebook, very much. So we all know what happened. So, please, your question, and then we have from Mr. Sven Ilman.
My name is Raul Eriksson, is coming from Sweden and Silk. I have a question with me, and we haven't touched that question here today, but I want to do that. And the question is, in Sweden we have a big problem because migrants is coming over to Sweden and sit down all day for beg for money in the streets. And it's a very difficult question, and I wonder how can we help for working with that question.
The political foundations at the European level could solve the problem that the Sweden people have with the migrants begging in the streets?
What I mean that I think in the future maybe ever Silk can with we can help with other things, because we must help these people in their own country so they don't need to travel over to other country and sit all day beg for money. We must help them. I don't really know how we can do it, but we must talk about that question.
I'm trying to ask some briefly, because at the moment we do have a partnership agreement between Sweden and Romanian government, and actually there are projects that are developing in common, for instance, not only with Sweden but also other countries. And while we're talking about migrants that are begging you know, doing things here, that's my view as well, because these people are going from Romania because of the economical context and social context, and looking for, you know, something. And that's a marginal resource that may use for income, quick and fast, you know, fast and easy. But as well, in other way, is their right to travel and, you know, whatever they want in EU, because they are member of this, you know, space that we are talking about. So indeed, we have to work more in Romania, and we are doing that also within the European funds. We are investing in so-called vulnerable groups that are, you know, having this tendency to leave Romania for such practices in Western Europe. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for your kindness. It wasn't on the topic, but anyway.
My question goes to the representative of the government. So what is your strategy to make a thing that happened 2013, where a couple of members from the parliament tried to create a law for foundations similar to the law what we have in Russia, that means not to allow foundations to finance parties direct or indirectly? Did you scan that? Did you have an idea how to avoid that, what we saw in 2013, and which was like help of the Americans and the German embassy to convince the prime minister to fight against this law or this proposal? So how you see the future of foreign foundations here in Romania and the need for building up democracy here?
Democracy is about participation and transparency. That's my short definition of it. You know, and participation of, first of all, Romanian people, if I think about Romanian democracy, bringing knowledge and the means to and tools for people to participate in the democratic process. It's also the contribution of foreign foundations and NGOs and even companies. I'm saying that being aware of some programs, social programs, CSR of companies that contribute to that. Well, to be honest, I'm for 3 months only in the government. That's not an excuse, you know, that I would say, well, I don't know what happened before, because I know very well, and I was very critical actually to some measures of various institutions related to civil society. and the way how the civil society was treated. From my point of view, civil society should be encouraged to have more participation into the process, because just answer to your question now, to your remark now, because you had a remark quite interesting. I'm not saying that NGOs are not democratic institutions. I'm just saying that they're not representative in a democratic context. They're not elected. Of course, they're part of the...
But I have to interrupt, because when you call foundations not democratic, this is wrong. We are living in one common Europe. Of course we are democratic. It doesn't matter if we are elected or not. We have the right to speak.
Of course, you don't understand what I mean. Yeah, we're talking about two different things. What I'm saying is about representative legitimacy to represent people. That's a different... that's why democracy is invented. Because we give power to a small number of people through elections. Of course, we may have a voice and participate into the process as NGOs, as journalists, as whatever, you know. But that's a role. You cannot be representative of somebody, because you are not. That's what I'm saying.
No,
funders. You may represent your funders. That's true.
Yeah, but nobody from the foundations is claiming this thing that we are like democratic things or taking a part. That we are like elected by somebody. I think, but you have to understand, we are here, the foreign foundations, I speak for my foundation, the Adner Foundation, to help our partners who share the same mindset. And we do this European-wide. We have the European Center for European Studies, former Martin Center. We are operating European-wide. And of course, we are Democrats, and if we are democratic elected or not, it doesn't play a role. We are Democrats.
Okay, just a second.
Just to him now. You said you are replacing the politician action in the action. That's why I mentioned that to you, because you are not representative of the people elected. Because you are saying you are replacing the voice of politicians.
Then you get it wrong. Yeah. You get it wrong. We are transmitting information.
Sven, thank you very much. Just a second. It's very difficult, because everybody who is acting in civil society wants to be in the government. People involved in the political foundations want to be in the parties. And now everybody wants to be moderator. But I am the moderator. So please, let's stop on it. And as according to agenda, and we know that in Romania, in Germany, in Belgium, we have to stick the agenda. And we are close to the conclusions. If it's very important what Mr. Haase has to say, he may say now. And after that, I will pass the floor to Mr. Arnold Kamel for the closing remarks, if everyone agrees. If not, anyway, the microphone is now at myself.
I think it's been said, we don't claim to represent, that's the main point. It's information transmission, like media also do, it's bringing people together. That's our role. And I think that should be underlined, yeah. That's it.
Both of the microphones are very rich. So, for the closing remarks, it's my pleasure to give the floor to Mr. Arnold Kamel.
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. Ladies and gentlemen, when we started the work of our working group, Citizenship, under my chairmanship in the framework of the European Network of Political Foundations, it was very much debated inside ENOP why we need such a kind of working group on citizenship, because for us also as political foundations, it might sometimes be easier to talk about democracy promotion, to talk about development cooperation, because in these areas we can somewhat provide the good for the others, and we can be the good pupils on the earth that are giving the good things to the outside world. But when it comes to the third term that I also see at our roll-up of ENOP, to the political dialogue, sometimes we were also stuck in the situation to say, well, shall we really do this kind of groundwork to go down there and do the really hard things involving the people in this kind of debates about the European Union? And when we started the work in the working group, I might have had in the beginning maybe a naive perspective, and I said, okay, we will go in and debate the issue of citizenship. But I found myself as the chairman of this working group in the situation that one member of our working group was even contesting Europe as a concept. So you could already see also in this working group that even the term of European Union, European integration, this whole process was not understood by everyone that was sitting around, that they were in dealing with this issue of the working group on citizenship. But in the very end, we did manage to overcome somewhat the differences, and one of the outcomes is this kind of policy paper. On the other hand, this debate somewhat also reflected the current state of affairs, I would say, of European integration. What we can see also as a follow-up of the last elections to the European Parliament is somewhat a phenomenon that also people are now sitting in the European Parliament that have no interest in European integration as such, that are denying this kind of existence of European integration process. And I think from that perspective, it was very valuable to also have this kind of debate among political foundations coming from the far left to the center-right in the whole spectrum of European political foundations, and to debate these issues. And in the very end, what we can also see nowadays is that European integration and the European Union is challenged, I think, the hardest times as we have ever seen in the history of European integration. We have been used to being challenged as Europeans by outside actors. This has had its up and downs in the history of European integration. We can even see it nowadays with new emerging actors that might contest our European values, our European approaches. But what we very often underestimate also as political foundations is that Europe and European integration is also very much contested by its citizens. And I do not want to enter into this debate whether Europe is an elitist project or whether it's about citizens. I think we should not forget very much the citizen dimension. Therefore, we said if you're writing a policy paper, we have to integrate the citizens. And therefore, we said we have to entitle this policy paper Reconnecting Europe with the Citizens. And in this whole debate that we are facing nowadays with European integration, it is in the very end a debate, and if you go down to the very real points of this debate, it's a debate about two issues, two values that were somewhat fundamental for European integration. On the one hand, it's about solidarity, and on the other hand, it's about trust. What we can see nowadays in all the different developments in European integration, be it the debate about the Grexit, the Brexit, migration, whatsoever, we see that solidarity and trust that we always have taken for granted in European integration are not entirely sure and are not entirely shared by the citizens of European integration. And I think, and this is the role where political foundations are coming in, I think in those challenging times where we really have to debate these very core issues of European integration, we also have, as political foundations, the task to inform our people from all the different political angles that we might represent on the concept of European integration, on its core basic values, and on the functioning of this European Union. Because if people do not even know the functioning and decision-making of European integration, we cannot expect them to understand what a two-pack, a six-pack, banking union, migration issues, whatever they are at the European level. And I think this is very core for us as political foundations to do this kind of job, to go out, to not shy away from sometimes very dense debates. And I do recall that our working group also hosted one debate in Athens in a very hot moment of the Greek issue, and I can explain you that the debate here was a very moderate one compared to the one we had in Athens. But I think this is one of our core tasks, that we are not shying away of this debate, and that we also let the people present their opinion, and we have to stand and fight for our values. This is also our job as political foundations, what we have to do, because in the very end, as also America was mentioned in the debate, I think in analogy maybe to the United States of America, we also have in the very, very far future come to the point where we say in Europe we trust. And this must also not come from any kind of, whether we define it as elites or whatever, this has to come from the citizens, that they see an added value in European integration. We all know that it's far from being perfect, but this is our job to move it ahead, this whole project of European integration. Having said that, as the co-president of ENOP, I also have somewhat the protocol obligations in that respect, to not only thanking the host organizations, the representation of the European Commission here in Romania, but also our partner and member institute, the ISD, for the great hospitality that you have offered to us, and also for bringing such an interested audience to this venue here. I would also like to thank our moderator for moderating this kind of debate. I would like to thank the co-panelists for their input, especially also my team, I would say, of my working group for helping me in this somewhat mission impossible in drafting a policy paper on reconnecting Europe with its citizens. And last but not least, I would like to thank, and now I'm really speaking in my function as co-president of ENOP, I would like to thank my staff of the ENOP Secretariat in Brussels, Alina Gakova, and also Friederike Genslen. Unfortunately, Friederike will leave the ENOP family at the end of August. Friederike, you were also somewhat the mastermind and somewhat the brain and face of ENOP during the last years, and you also contributed quite a lot to the success of this whole network. So many thanks especially to you, and also lots of success for your future endeavors, in which direction they might go. Never forget us here at ENOP. And maybe just to end, not on a sentimental note, but on a more future-oriented note, when we are talking about European integration, we should always remember a sentence said by one of the founding fathers of European integration, not very well known because he was more a bureaucrat and not that much a politician, a German called Walter Hallstein, who once said, "European integration can be compared somewhat to a bicycle, to a bike. It always needs to be in motion to be stable and to move forward in this direction." And just to end on that, I think it's us, whether we call ourselves elites, whether we call ourselves political foundations, or whether we call ourselves simply as European citizens. We have to jump in the driving seat in order to move the project of European integration forward, because this Europe is affecting us every day. We cannot neglect any kind of ownership that we have towards this European project. So I would like to thank also the audience for debate, and with that I simply want to say, and that's unfortunately the only thing that I can still remember from my Romanian roommates that I had during my study times, "Noapte bună." Thank you.